I was born and raised in the small town of Etna, E-T-N-A, Etna, Pennsylvania, Western Pennsylvania, a suburb of Pittsburgh. Born, raised there, and educated there. I might add that my parents were fresh off the boat, so to speak, from Europe. From at that time, they came over as Austrian citizens. That part of Austria where they lived was later incorporated into the country of Yugoslavia. My mother could speak only Croatian. My father spoke Croatian, German, and English. He'd been a businessman in Vienna. Because my mother couldn't speak any English, naturally, I didn't know English myself until I went to school. So my primary language was Croatian.
Michael Novosel enlisted in the Army Air Corps on February 7, 1941. It was the first of three wars in which he would volunteer and fight. He flew bombers in World War II and transport planes in Korea. Novosel was working as a commercial airline pilot in 1963 when he felt compelled by a deep sense of patriotism to return to active duty. He relinquished his rank of lieutenant colonel in the Air Force Reserves in order to fly Army medevac helicopters in Vietnam, known as dustoff.
I did not volunteer for the Vietnam War to go to battle. I was 42 years old. I knew how to fly. I knew how to fly everything that flew. And I wanted to instruct, to show the young people how to exist, how to live, how to do their job in what I call a high-risk environment. When I ended up in the Army, why, they didn't see it that way. They sent me to work just like anybody else.
On October 2nd, 1969, Novosel and his crew had been flying for 7 hours when they received yet another mission.
We received the mission to go up to the Cambodian border. That's where the mission plotted out. And it was a flaky mission, if you will. By that I mean, we didn't know very much. All we know that we were needed up there. And I proceeded to go up there, rather chagrined, because I thought my day was just about over after flying 7 hours, but now it had quite a few number of hours to go before I was through. What had happened was that we had a three-company strike force attacking known Viet Cong positions. The intelligence evidently was in error, and the force that they were attacking was much stronger than they anticipated. The lead element was cut off, and the commander of troops decided to disengage. In other words, he retrograded. That's a fancy term for a retreat. And he left a group of soldiers that had been cut off to their own devices. And I was asked to go extricate, in other words, get them out of there if I could. All were wounded. We make two abortive attempts that failed. And of course, every time that I'm down there at the surface to rescue these people, I'm met with machine gun fire and other fire from around the clock, so to speak. Since they're surrounded, the enemy is all around, they're able to fire at me. Required a different procedure from what we were doing. I decided to just skim along the ground with my helicopter, never stopping, in an area where I assumed, from the way the firing was going, where our friendly troops had to be. You can tell this by the way the firing pattern goes. And sure enough, I assumed the right position. And what we wanted to do was to have these wounded people stand up as I went by them real close, and then we would yank them on board, grab them by the wrist or whatever, and pull them on board while the enemy is still trying to get us. Well, it worked. And we loaded up the aircraft with about 8 or 9, maybe 10 people. And it's a Huey, and we can't hold very many more. Besides, the medic can't do any work on helping them with their wounds. And I take them to a special forces camp nearby. It's about a 10-minute flight. Drop them off, get some fuel, return. In other words, I did this three different times. I'd load up 9 or 10, take them to the special forces camp, get more fuel, and return. on my last pickup, one of my crewmen said that he sees a friendly, apparently a friendly man waving a rag, but he's behind us. So the quickest way to get to him is for me to hover the helicopter backwards to his position and then have him pulled on board. But as we came to a halt to pick this man up, and as we yanked him on board, that's when a man stood up about 30 yards in front of me with his AK and emptied it at me personally. Part of a bullet hit my hand, which was on the stick, which caused the stick to go back, and another bullet projectile glanced off the rubber sole of my boot, so that it caused that leg to go in, causing the other leg to go out, pushing on the pedals. When you're doing this to a helicopter, you know, these are the controls. The nose goes off to one side, the nose goes way up, and we're about to crash, except that I have enough sense to pull on the power, which then raises me up. It keeps me from hitting the ground at this odd angle. The man that's being pulled on board now slips back out, but luckily for him, his legs straddle the skids, so he doesn't fall further. By the time we get him back on board, we're now 60 feet in the air, and my co-pilot got on the controls with me, and we got out of there.
In all, Novosel performed 15 extremely hazardous extractions and was credited with the saving of 29 lives.
The medal was presented to me by President Nixon in June of 1971. My son actually served with me in Vietnam. We flew a number of missions as pilot and co-pilot. So when I went home after the action, he wrote me a letter stating that I'd been recommended for the Medal of Honor. It's a most unusual situation. I suppose I'm the only man to receive the Medal of Honor who was informed initially by his son. I had the privilege of evacuating 5,589 wounded people in 2 years, two different tours of duty. And just that opportunity alone leaves you with a sense of awe, so to speak, self-inspired awe. How the heck could I have done it? I never thought about it. And I never kept records. I never would have known that I evacuated that many, except that the system that we had kept, the people kept records on us. And when my time was up, that's what they told me. Certainly what my country has done for me, it has done a lot for me that I never expected. If I am anything in this world, I owe it to my country. They gave me my education. They gave me my opportunity at life. They gave me opportunity to serve. A lot of people don't look at the idea of an opportunity to serve your country. I was able to volunteer three different times. I was never drafted. And what I am, I am good or bad, I'm a product of my country. Mm-hmm.